I don't even have a mic stand.
So, recently I put up a poll on Twitter asking, what should I do my next video on? Because, I don't know, I'm indecisive sometimes. I gave three options. The Upper Peninsula, the first movie from James Cameron, and the marketing for Lego's Bionicle line. I gave the poll a couple days, checked them when it was done, and oh my goodness, you people are still fans of that franchise. But, this got me thinking. Why is it people are still so invested in these Danish building toys? I mean, Bionicle ended what, how many years ago? Oh gosh, I guess I'm old. So, I guess this is something we should talk about. Now, before we talk about Bionicle, we need to understand how LEGO got here. Before Bionicle launched, you definitely had toys with stories. You know, your G.I. Joes, your Transformers, you get the idea. These were toys that had lore, that had a backstory. G.I. Joe vs. Cobra.
Before time began, there was the cube.
All that. But that was all about what came before. There wasn't really a focus on ongoing narrative. But there was a little movie that came along and really changed how people approach storytelling and toys. I don't think it's really appreciated how Star Wars saved LEGO. LEGO Star Wars plucked LEGO out of the gutter, and it gave it a path to becoming the number one tire manufacturer in the world. What set LEGO Star Wars apart was that not only was there that pre-established backstory, but thanks to the then new prequel trilogy, plus the Clone Wars and the sequels, there was that ongoing story that helps keep kids emotionally invested in all of this. There was just one problem. See, this wasn't really LEGO's franchise, it was Lucasfilm's. So to LEGO, the dream would be something with that sweet, sweet ongoing storyline and relatable characters, but also something that was wholly original, with zero licensing fees going to anyone else. Now, you'd expect this is where Bionicle comes in, right? Well, not quite. Before Bionicle, LEGO launched a few other character-based lines. There was Throwbots, which was actually pretty good, and Roboriders, which wasn't. But more importantly, both of these projects had the same issue as older toy lines. The narrative wasn't ongoing. So, after an attempt called Boneheads of Voodoo Island, I'm not even kidding, that was actually its name, LEGO enlisted a guy called Christian Faber, and Bionicle launched in the fall of 2001. And right away, Bionicle just flew.
Six heroes, one destiny. You can discover their skills, unlock their powers, and join their quest. Can you find the power? Bionicle. Each set sold separately.
There was a very basic setup to tell a really simple story. Darkness rising, heroes have to put a stop to it. But what made it so clever was that everything was a part of that story. The collectible masks? Yeah, they exist in this world. The heroes need to find them, by the way, so help the Toa and collect them all. Oh, and while you're at it, why not enter this contest so you can win the gold masks they get by unlocking their full power? Even things like the Combiner models or the Happy Meal toys existed as characters within this world. And we haven't even gotten into the comic books. Yeah, LEGO promoted these things with full-size comic books published by DC friggin' Comics, illustrated by people that would later work on titles like The Walking Dead and Batman Arkham Asylum. But the big kicker? A free-to-play, point-and-click game called the Madanui Online Game. This let you explore the island where Bionicle's first few years takes place, watching the year's story unfold right in front of you. Without it, I honestly don't know if that first year would have been the hit that it was, you know, really giving the franchise the gas it needed to go for almost 10 years. Seriously, if you take one thing away from this video, it's that you should play that game. 2002 from a marketing perspective was more of the same, but then we hit 2003. And 2003 is where things get exciting. 2003 was where this franchise started to become a proper multimedia franchise. Madanui Online gets a sequel, LEGO launches a series of short novels called the Bionicle Chronicles, telling the story of the past few years, and the story going forward. There was a game released for home consoles to mixed results. We even got a feature-length movie.
Bionicle, Mask of Light, the movie.
It was straight to home video, and boy did it show, but we didn't care. It was a Bionicle movie. And with it came a huge expansion of the universe. Suddenly, Bionicle was much more than a simple tale of good guys versus bad guys. Now, 2004 and 2005 were, from a marketing standpoint, more of the same. More books, more comics, two more direct-to-video movies, kind of an interesting development with a Final Fantasy style RPG in 2005, but 2006, well,
things are about to get weird.
See, this is the year where Bionicle starts to get some major pop culture crossover appeal, and it was all thanks to one song. Yes, it's the moment you've all been waiting for. Wait, hold on. Stop! Look. The Baraka rap happened, it was Lego trying to make Bionicle hip and edgy with that urban gangsta flavor, just accept it and move on. But this is actually kind of interesting. See, Bionicle had featured music of a kind, but aside from one promo CD that happened to have three songs on it, it was mostly original tunes or flash animations, you know, that sort of thing. This wasn't exactly like Halo making video game soundtrack releases a thing. Nobody was flocking to stores to buy a Mata Nui Online game soundtrack. Though, if somebody did, I'd have bought one. But then, two important things happened. The Toa and Nika had a storyline centered around overcoming loss to fight evil, and the All-American Rejects released a hit new song called Move Along. The next thing you know, that song became the de facto theme for the Toa and Nika. Seriously, every single ad is set to that song. If you were the right age in 2006, when you hear the All-American Rejects just let it all out, you think,
you may look like a hero, you may feel like a hero. You may be one in IK, you may be many. You may have new masks, new armor, new equipment. You may activate your powerful light-up sword and load your multi-shot Zamo launcher. But it's not what you've got, it's what you do with it that makes you a hero.
If 2007 was described in three words, it'd be up to 11. The storyline got more intense, with the Toa going to the darkest place in the Torrent universe, the Great Spirit dying, Mataro giving up his life to save the world, and with that intensity, LEGO's marketing ambitions ramped up too. This was the year the company started a long-running professional relationship with the rock band Cryo Shell, and made a mini-movie to show off the badass action the Toa get into. It's hard to explain it 16 years later, but this was really something else to watch us all unfold. Now, while 2008 may have changed the story forever, the marketing was more the same. The last few years of Bionicle's life were kind of unique, though. There was a mix of old and new in 2009, with the first movie in years hitting shelves to mixed results. And on the game front, Bionicle ramped up what online games could even be for this franchise, with a 3D fighting game featuring that year's line of characters. And then in 2010, we got Bionicle graphic novels hitting bookshelves. They may have just been reprints of the comic books, but it was really cool to see something like it as a farewell to the franchise. Oh, yeah, this was also the year where Bionicle ended. Yeah, it's been 13 years since Bionicle ended. Lego must have done something right, because look at how much people still care about these toys. We have websites cataloging every piece of that marketing media. People spent over $100 on Lego just so they could get a brick-built set of Tahu. Heck, I made a lot of these points in a presentation at an AmeriCorps conference, and people were cheering about how Lego sold all this. And do you know what? A lot of what Bionicle did, Lego would go on to do again. Hero Factory got the comic books, it even got the same animation studio that did The Legend Reborn. A few years later, we got the Ninjago series, using a lot of Bionicle's storytelling, along with something new for Lego, a full-length TV series. And that's really where all this ends. You know, in some weird space between ARGs and every movie trailer feeling like it's the same movie trailer, Bionicle offered something really unique. It wasn't just selling you some toys with a distant story, it was selling you an experience. You were being invited on an adventure, one that audiences really aren't going to forget anytime soon. It came in, it shook things up, and to be honest, we may never see anything like it again. Yeah, they didn't do it, worked. Why do you think it was such a fa- Hey, thanks for watching. Big shout out to the TTV channel, their series Bionicle Autopsy was a huge inspiration for this. Big thanks also to the Biomedia Project, a lot of the media that you saw on this would have been lost without them. And one last thing, this video basically started as a live presentation at AmeriCorps conference, so a huge thanks to Notre Dame Mission volunteers and senior teaching fellows. Couldn't have done this without you guys. Thank you all so much for watching, and hit that subscribe button if you want to see more. Or not, it's your call.